Hello and welcome to our presentation on GitOps and TFE. My name is May Large. I'm an architect manager here at State Farm, primarily responsible for the delivery engineering topic. What that means is my team and I partner heavily with different teams at State Farm, change management, and the different platform owners at State Farm, enabling our cloud environments, both within our walls and out in the public cloud. We partner with these teams to deliver a compliant, developer-friendly way to get changes, code changes, to the hands of our customers. I am joined today by Pinky, and I will let her introduce herself.
Hi, I'm Priyanka Ravi. As May mentioned, I also go by Pinky. I am a software developer on May's team. And for the last year and a half, I have been primarily involved in helping bring GitOps into the organization.
Thank you, Pinky. So we both work for State Farm. In fact, I've been here for about 14 years. State Farm is a known name in the insurance business. We've been number one in auto insurance since 1942. Number one in homeowners since 1964. We are 36 on the Fortune 500 list. And as far as our manpower goes, we have 19,200 agents, 59,000 employees, and 1,800 software developers. These software developers are our customers for the topic that Pinky and I drive here at State Farm. And just bonus info, that building that they're showing is our Phoenix hub where both Pinky and I are located. So to wrap up introductions, Pinky and I, let's get the disclaimer out of the way. Pinky and I are both here expressing our individual opinions and experiences. We are not speaking on behalf of State Farm. All right, let's get down to it. State Farm momentum. These are the things gaining adoption and momentum around State Farm as it relates to the topic that we drive. First off, infrastructure as code using Terraform, and then we later on pivot to Terraform Enterprise, which we more often call as TFE. So about 4 years ago now, as we were venturing out to the public cloud, we came to this realization. On one side, the developers got to understand that they needed to better be aware, better be understanding of the infrastructure that powers the software that they wrote. On the other hand, our infrastructure folks came to a realization that we need to start managing and operating on these infrastructure resources just as we do with code. So these two realizations naturally translated over to Terraform. Terraform is State Farm's strategic infrastructure as code solution. About a year and a half into using Terraform open source, State Farm, with my team's involvement, did a proof of value on bringing in TFE. And fast forward to today, we have been using TFE for almost a year now. Next momentum, GitOps. You saw in our stats, we've been number one for several years. We're serious about keeping that competitive advantage. And one of the ways we're doing that is by significantly reducing lead time for changes. How quickly do we get innovation from idea and into the hands of our customers? And that's where GitOps comes in. GitOps is a continuous deployment methodology for cloud native applications. It thrives in the fundamental principle that Git is the source of truth for your entire declarative system. And what I mean by a declarative system, it starts with your declarative infrastructure, the config that gets applied on it, the application or applications that then get applied to those infrastructure resources, and even the policies that are enforced on every single one of these layers or resources, those are all done via Git. GitOps manages it. So because it's all managed as code, it naturally resides in Git. Second, every code change, the validation that takes place, making sure it's of quality, the different levels to test, and making sure that it's free from security vulnerabilities, those all happen in Git too, in a pipeline. Last, and a key piece, the collaboration that takes place in every code change. As committers, collaborators weigh in a code review, also within Git, all the way to the approval of that change via a merge request to get realized in production, everything is done in Git. That's where GitOps is. It's operations by pull request. Now let's talk about the whys, the benefits of these solutions that we brought in. First, why GitOps, right? You can Google this and you're gonna get a ton of results on why I should bring GitOps to my organization. But these are the top three reasons why State Farm adopted GitOps. Number one, it's developer friendly. We know that our ability to stay competitive is in the hands of our developers, innovating nonstop, hands on the keyboard. And what better way to promote that, but to provide a way to deploy their changes, get their changes realized to in the hands of our customers right away, remaining developer friendly. And it is because our developers are familiar with Git. They use it day in and out. They don't have to understand yet another tooling, yet another solution just to get their changes out the door. They stay in the ecosystem, which is in Git, that they thrive and they collaborate with fellow committers. Second reason, the history. I know I may be sounding repetitive here a little bit because everything's Git, 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 right? So the rich history is already in Git, and that is the history, the audit trail that we can harvest and present to our auditors. How did this change make it? What were the validations that took place? Who approved it? That audit trail is all in Git, and we're just harvesting that in the case of an audit. Last and certainly not the least, on the why GitOps, we are now comfortable with component level changes getting realized straight to production. By component, you can think of a single microservice with a change. And a developer who made that change, if it had gone through the proper pipeline rigor and the approval, it will get realized in production right away. Key DevOps principle, small miniature changes, less context switching, right? Because it's such a minute change, we're able to properly observe, monitor, how is this change performing in production? And even if it fails, since it's such a small change, we can definitively make a decision on whether to fix it forward, which is easier, not much context that has changed, or even roll it back if it comes down to it. That's why GitOps. Next, why TFE? Two main reasons why we brought in TFE. Number one, as you saw, we cater to 1,800 software developers, and not all of them are operating in the public cloud. We brought in TFE to eliminate the responsibility from our customers from having to figure out where to stash the state files behind the infrastructure that they're now managing. With TFE, it's just, you don't have to worry about state management. TFE does it for you. Second key feature, Sentinel. In an organization like us, we have compliance requirements that we need to abide by. And Sentinel gives us that. And even better, we can describe these policies as code. And it shows the transparency on what are these policies that we're running nonstop in every one of these workspaces. But before I wrap up the whys, the benefits, I'm gonna touch on why GitOps with TFE, right? This is a match made in heaven after all. So in retrospect, we really could have released GitOps much earlier with Terraform open source. At the time at State Farm, we were still actively standing up TFE. And yet, yes, we've allowed early adopters to use our alpha and beta version of GitOps, but it was the right decision to make GitOps generally available with TFE. And here's why. Number one, convention. The product, that goes into the hands of our customers, the product that's constantly changing, that translates into a TFE workspace. That same product translates into the TFE teams that we provision for our customers that are now tied to our identity provider. So that convention carries throughout our entire solution stack. And you know what that achieves us? Faster onboarding, because the convention is just the product name, right? Faster troubleshooting also. When things break at the different integration points, all we have to ask our customers is, what is the product name? And we can take it from there. In fact, even they can troubleshoot these problems by themselves, again, because of the convention. Second, TFE met our non-functional requirements. First off, we love the secured variables. Why? Because, as you know, in every automation, there are secrets involved. And we're able to set those secrets in our customers' TFE workspaces without giving them the ability to glean into the values of these secrets. Such a key feature, such a huge lift for us. Second, RBAC. The permissions model in TFE is so well thought out. From the organization permissions, which we so use because we're the owners of GitOps, and down to the individual workspaces, the permissions that product teams and product team members can add themselves to, following yet the convention again, right? Add themselves to fulfill their specific responsibilities. It naturally isolates these individual workspaces as well. Last, VCS integration. In hindsight, TFE with VCS integration is very similar with when GitOps was first released by Weaveworks using Flux. And I'm just gonna leave it at that. Hold that thought, please, because Pinky will get into the specifics in a little bit. A bonus on the why GitOps and TFE. 1,800 software developers. Not all of them are operating in a public cloud. And yet, we're able to give them that experience on using Terraform, on operating in an infrastructure as code ecosystem, because they're now taking on the responsibility of managing infrastructure as code on resources that they're very familiar with. GitLab groups, GitLab repos, which we also call as config repos. Now that the benefits, the whys, are out of the way, I'm gonna turn it over to Pinky, and she will walk us through the different GitOps workflows that we've enabled here at State Farm.
Thank you, May. So I'm gonna be walking through a few workflows for the platforms that we've enabled, and I'm gonna be starting with our Kubernetes flow. So as you can see, it starts pretty much the same way with the developer pushing to a source code repo, and you probably already have a CI/CD pipeline set up in your flow that does your tests and your deployments currently. What is a little different is this concept of the config repo, and that is not something that we've come up with here at State Farm. It's actually an industry term associated with GitOps, but what we've done differently is kind of how we've set it up and stuff like that. What is the purpose of this config repo, though? The purpose of the config repo is to provide a full audit trail from the code change to the progression in the delivery pipeline. It logs who approved the change, and it goes all the way to the deployment of the change. So what we do is that the creation of the config repos is automated in our process, and the integrity of the repo is enforced on a recurring schedule. And May is going to go into that in a little bit in further detail. But the first thing to note is our master branch in our config repo is our default branch, and it's also protected. And this enforces that there is no possibility of a rewrite to the history in that branch. And also, we have settings in place that make sure that nobody can do a direct push to master. Next thing in here is this merge request. And this merge request has some permissions that are locked down as well. And one of those permissions is that it requires an approver, but it also requires that the approver has to be from a set list of approvers that are the product's owning managers. So one of them has to approve it. Also, merge request committers cannot approve their own change. So let's say even though May is the manager of a product and she initiates the change, she cannot actually go in and approve her own change. Lastly, the config repo has settings so that it cannot be deleted, and that's for auditing purposes, to keep that audit trail. Now, between the CI/CD pipeline to the config repo, you might see this line that says GitOps CLI. This is something that we've developed internally. And the GitOps CLI, we actually have it deployed as a Docker image, and we call that in our CI/CD pipeline. And it does a few things to get to the config repo. Firstly, it actually creates a branch in the config repo, and it uses a naming convention of the commit SHA. So the commit SHA from the source code commit is how it's named to the config repo. Secondly, it creates a commit on that branch. And the commit that it creates actually has the files that are required, the instructions to perform a deployment. Lastly, it creates a merge request using that branch. So that merge request contains details such as our evidence of test link, and also it links back to the source code commit. So now there's a merge request in our config repo. So when May goes in, she can actually go check that the test passed, and she can see the change that was in our source code repo. And she can decide whether she thinks that's a good change that should be going into prod. If she thinks that the change should go into prod, then she will approve it and merge it into master. So once that change is in master in our config repo, it will do two things. First, you see on the right side that it says the K8s cluster, and then it has the Kubernetes cluster, and has the namespace, and then it has an operator in there. And that operator that we use is actually Flux. Now, Flux is going to continuously pull the master branch in the config repo on a set interval that we've set. And what it does is if it sees a change in those deployment files in master, it will automatically deploy that change to production. Another thing that it does is it actually also has a git sync interval that you can set. And that interval will basically check for anything that's out of sync. So it'll automatically make sure that everything's back in sync. It'll force apply those changes. So the bottom thing in this diagram is our webhook. So our webhook is also something that we've created internally as well. And this webhook is listening for merge request events. So it's continuously checking for merge request events. And if it sees that the status is merged, then it will kick off a change record to our asset inventory. And that change record is also going to use that commit SHA that was from the source code commit. So basically, in that way, the commit SHA gets carried all the way to production and to even being recorded in the asset inventory. And that's how that's tracked. Next, we have our Cloud Foundry workflow. And this workflow is exactly the same to the config repo. Nothing has changed there. The only thing that changes is to get to production, it uses continuous deployment pipelines. There's no Flux in this process. So what we've done is in these continuous deployment pipelines, we've added lots of reusable pipeline stages to ease with the adoption of GitOps by our consumers. Lastly, we have our public cloud workflow. Again, this one is the exact same to the config repo. Nothing has changed, but you see the integration of Terraform Enterprise here. So instead of Flux or the pipelines, we actually are using Terraform Enterprise. If your deployment is as simple as a Terraform plan and apply, then you can actually make use of the VCS integration in TFE. And what it does is when something is put into master, it kicks off an external pipeline that runs that Terraform plan and apply in TFE. And so in that way, it kind of acts like Flux is what May was alluding to. And so another thing is you can really take advantage of that CLI and API if you don't want to use the VCS integration. And also you can still do an external pipeline as well, and it will still kick off a pipeline in TFE. And now I'm going to kick it back over to May, who's going to go more in detail of how we actually set up that config repo and how we maintain it.
Thank you, Pinky. So now you have a better understanding of these workflows. What is a config repo? Let's talk about what powers that. Terraform modules. These modules are what we use. It's in-house developed. Are what we use to create lockdown GitLab groups and GitLab repositories. So if I have product A, right, that translates into a config group, a lockdown GitLab group, in order to use GitOps. This product A is made up of, let's say, a UI, an API, a database, and maybe a couple Lambda functions, right? So five components that make up this product A. Each of these translates to a config repo nested underneath that config group. It's also locked down. So How did we do these modules? Well, we leveraged the GitLab Terraform provider. And truth be told, we do have null resources that delegate down to some custom scripts in order for us to achieve the true lockdown requirement that we have to comply by. Next, you may be wondering, where are these modules hosted? They're in TFE. We are a tenant. GitOps is a tenant in our TFE instance. So these two modules that we provide for our customers are hosted in TFE using the private module registry. Easier for our customers to see, what do these modules do? How do I use these? Inputs, outputs, the README documentation is all in that TFE UI, and even the versions that we've released to our customers. I've also touched on the workspaces, right? That's kind of how we achieve a lot of that convention. Even with these TFE workspaces, we use Terraform to stand them up. It's pretty obvious in every one of our automation pieces, if we can use Terraform, we use Terraform, embracing our infrastructure as code solution. Last, secret sauce, scheduled pipelines. We call it the enforcer. Every night, we have a scheduled pipeline. Obviously, the recurrence can be adjusted. Beauty of it being a scheduled pipeline. Every night, it goes out to every single one of those workspaces, TFE workspaces, under the GitOps organization. And it does a Terraform apply. It's our way of, again, embracing infrastructure as code. The code is your source of truth. And that is what gets realized as far as how your resources are configured and stood up. Not just the first time you went through it, but we reinforce it on a recurring basis. Now I'm going to turn it over again to Pinky to wrap us up.
Thanks, May. Okay, so we wanted to leave you guys with a couple thoughts. One being what's near and dear to May and I's heart, that Terraform is not just for public cloud. We hear this sometimes even in State Farm where people are come to us and they say, oh, we're going to Kubernetes. Why are we using Terraform when they're setting up their config repo? And we just want to really reiterate that there are so many more uses to Terraform. In our case, we're using the GitLab provider to stand up our config repos, and we're using the TFE provider to stand up our workspaces. So we really, it was kind of fun almost to get to see like different uses for it. And so we really hope that we've inspired you guys, one, to look into GitOps for your own company, in your own use, and also to really try to see how you can use Terraform and use TFE as well. And yeah, we really thank you guys for this opportunity to share our experiences. Thank y'all.